I'm Desiane Porter, and I'll be introducing Clee J. Jackson and Anthony Lewis. Clee J. Jackson is the president of the Greater Grand Rapids NAACP branch. Clee is currently finishing up his two-year elected term with the organization. Clee started his career with Blue Cross Blue Shield of Michigan 20 years ago as a provider services consultant. He is currently responsible for community and civic relations in the West Michigan region. Prior to joining the Blues, Clee worked for the Department of Health and Human Services as Assistant Program Manager in the Intergovernmental Affairs Division and Dental Benefit Providers, an affiliate of the United Healthcare Group as an Accountant Representative. Clee completed an executive education program on corporate community involvement at Boston College and his undergraduate studies in political and international studies at the University of the District of Columbia in Washington, D.C. Clee is a native of Grand Rapids, Michigan. His community involvement ranges from president of the board of directors for Baxter Community Center, board member K-Connect, past advisory member Lake Michigan College, Catch the Dream, board member Disability Advocates of Kent County, served as an executive chair for the American Cancer Society's 2010 Cattle Barons Ball, and was an executive cabinet member for the 2011 Catherine's Healthcare Capital Campaign. Anthony Lewis is the Director of Business and Community Affairs for the Michigan Department of Civil Rights. He has previously served as a community relations specialist for 10 years and an investigator with the Michigan Department of Civil Rights in Detroit for 5 years. Anthony is the department's liaison to the civil rights / human relations organizations across the state of Michigan. Anthony is currently building coalitions throughout the state of Michigan between law enforcement and community leaders via advocates and leaders for the police and the community trust. Anthony also leads the department's youth initiatives, working with school districts on programming and policy development, and was instrumental in developing the Michigan Youth Civil Rights Leadership Academy. In addition, Anthony has developed numerous presentations on cultural diversity and civil rights law. Anthony began his career in corporate America with FedEx Corporation, serving as a ramp operations manager in Newark, New Jersey, and station operations manager in multiple locations throughout Michigan and Ohio. Anthony is a graduate of Florida A&M University with a bachelor's degree in business, economics / labor relations. Clee Jackson and Anthony Lewis.
Are we good? Yeah. Is everybody awake? Yeah. Everybody awake this morning? Yeah. I want you to give yourself a round of applause. I know it's early, right? Early for me, so I decided to wear jeans and just a shirt, and see all my other brothers are dappered out this morning with their suits and all of that good stuff. How's everybody doing?
Good. Yeah.
How's everybody doing? Yeah. We fired up?
Yeah.
Fired up. So I'm Clee Jackson. I'm the president of the Greater Grand Rapids NAACP. And so it is an honor and a privilege to be here this morning to speak to such what looks like a very distinguished crowd of young men.
Yeah!
That's right. Because you know why it's an honor? Because you could have chosen to be anywhere else this morning. We know that you guys are challenged with school. You get up early every morning. and I'm just grateful to have an audience. So Mr. Lewis and I, who's a partner, we have a partnership with the Michigan Department of Civil Rights. And I think we started that partnership in September, right? And so that partnership involves us having an on-site investigator at the NAACP office. And the purpose of that investigator is really to allow folks in the community to come into a safe space in a safe place in order to discuss any potential discriminatory concerns, whether it be employment, whether it be housing, whether it be education, whether it be criminal justice issues, healthcare issues across the board. The benefit of having that partnership is that the Michigan Department of Civil Rights can actually file in real time a complaint with their agency, and we can do the same with NAACP. My role as NAACP president is to really, I have one, I would say, my number one goal is to have all of you young men at some point take my place. We have to create a pipeline of future leaders. I do not plan or do not intend to be in this space forever. I don't consider myself a senior, but I'm approaching that age bracket. So it is critically important that we support you, for one, that we encourage you, two, and that we love you, three, and that we give you all of the necessary resources, tools that we can give you in order to make you successful in this society. So one of the things we're going to talk about is knowing your rights. So a couple years ago, we started this whole campaign, NAACP, called Journey to Justice, Rights, Responsibilities, and Reform. And so we started that campaign after the shooting of Michael Brown in Ferguson, Missouri. So we got with the Grand Rapids Police Department, the city of Grand Rapids, and we said, hey, we are intentional in terms of creating the space to talk about reform and to talk about improving community police relations in the city of Grand Rapids. And also, our number one goal is to protect our young men, our young women, and our citizens in this community, period. And they should be able to walk the streets free from fear, free from harm, and understand that the police is here to protect and to serve them. And so we started that campaign, and we came up with 12 recommendations in order to move down that road, in order to protect your rights here in the great city of Grand Rapids, Michigan. And so that work was done in partnership with NAACP, the Grand Rapids Urban League, and LINC. I'm not going to go through all of the 12 reforms, but one of the reforms that we were successful in getting passed was to have all 300, I believe, police officers in the city of Grand Rapids outfitted in body cameras. Who in this audience, can one of you guys tell me, or a couple of you guys tell me, why is it important, or why do you think it's important for police officers to have and to wear body cameras? Yes.
So they can monitor what the police, make sure the police is doing what they're supposed to do.
Okay, good answer. What, anybody else? Why is that important? Anybody else? Yes?
There's various reasons. They use body cameras to see what's going on. Suspect, maybe suspects or maybe victims or anything going on. If the police are trying to be nice, mm-hmm. At that point, just say, please back away. And they don't back away. Now they have evidence that you know, didn't do the right thing. But if the police, were to do anything, you know, out of their job, you know, against the law, mm-hmm. Now they have evidence.
Mm-hmm.
If, you know, maybe the victim or the police wants to press charges or anything, mm-hmm. Now they have that.
That is exactly correct. So it's about, it comes down to accountability. So it comes down to that response, the R, the responsibility, and making sure these officers are accountable for their actions, not only the officers, but also that we as citizens are accountable for our actions. It goes both ways. It really does go both ways, but fundamentally, I want all of you guys to know that based on your constitutional rights, no officer should ever assault you and disrespect you as a citizen and disrespect and disregard your constitutional rights. That is what we are aligned to based on the United States of America and the constitutional rights that they have provided us as citizens. And by the way, it's funny because I was just having this conversation with some folks, and they said when the founders wrote that Constitution, they wrote the Declaration of Independence, they wrote that under the guise of not including us. But it's interesting how that document, how that very document protects us from police brutality and all of the other discriminatory practices that exist in this country, in this country. And so that is very important. So body cameras is now, all of the body cameras are worn by all police officers in GRPD, and has, I think, has proven to be very successful because it really tells the story. It tells the story of when someone is arrested, tells the story of when someone is stopped. It tells the true story. And then if there is an issue of rights being violated, as an organization, NAACP, we can address that issue quickly and effectively in the Michigan Department of Civil Rights. They can address that issue quickly and effectively. And again, we did that in partnership. We wrote all of these 12 reforms, NAACP, in partnership with the Grand Rapids Urban League and Link Community Revitalization to protect you guys. It was a lot of work. It was passed through the city commission. And so is there still work to be done? Absolutely. There's still work to be done. Another part of the, one of the other reforms that was included in the 12-point plan was to have all officers go through what we call training, implicit bias training, and testing. And so all officers, and not only the officers, but the administrative staff of Grand Rapids Police Department have gone through that implicit bias training. Who in here knows what implicit bias is? Or want to guess? So it has something to do with inherent prejudices. Yes, sir. You want to stand up and so we can hear you?
Intense training. That's what I think it has to do with it.
Say that again, I'm sorry.
Intense training.
Okay. Intense training.
Yeah, I think that's what it's part of it.
So what do you think the word bias means? Does it have something to do with prejudice, inherent prejudice, or?
I don't really know.
Okay. Yes, sir. You want to stand up and?
Isn't bias when you add your own opinion to story?
Mm-hmm. Yep, you're going down that. Anybody else want to help them? Did I hear something? You want to stand up, young man? Okay, that's good. So we did, implicit bias is when you have internal biases or prejudices that could be as a direct result of just things that you hear or hearsay, or because of the people that you hang around and they say, you know, well, you know, all Latino or black people are inherently guilty for wanting to engage in some type of crime. And so you believe that without having any personal experience or knowledge about that. And you're basing that bias on the person's skin color or race or socioeconomic status or whatever, or gender or whatever. And so what we did, one of the reforms, yes, sir.
I feel like that's a part of stereotype.
It is, that's exactly what it is. is definitely fundamentally stereotyping without having any knowledge or information to prove what you believe. It's because of maybe, again, what you have heard, what you have seen in the news, what you have seen on TV. And that's really exactly what it comes down to, and it comes down to stereotyping. And so one of the reforms was to have all of the officers, all of the administrative staff go through not only training, implicit bias training, but also testing to address their bias issues so that they will not take those issues out on the road when their fundamental purpose is to what? Protect and to what?
Serve.
Let's say that again, is to what? Protect and to serve. And so we went through this whole process of reforms in order to say fundamentally improve the community police relationships between GRPD and folks in our community. Let me say that again. We went through this entire process for almost a year to improve the relationship between the Grand Rapids Police Department and us. And so we're moving down that vein. I think 10 or 11 of the recommendations have been implemented. They have been executed. And are there problems? Absolutely, there are problems. So as an organization, NAACP, we are monitoring. We are constantly engaged with local law enforcement at the GRPD level, but also at the county level, at the Justice Department level. We are continuously engaged with a variety of different stakeholders to make sure your rights are protected and respected. And so Mr. Lewis is going to come up and talk about some of those rights, some of these everyday situations that we might find ourselves in, and how to respond, and what is the responsibility, the role of law enforcement, and then what is our role? What really is our role? One of the things that, and I'm sure Brother Lewis is gonna, he might touch on this as well, but fundamentally, you have a fundamental right to remain silent. Period. If you are stopped by law enforcement, you have a fundamental right to remain silent. You have a fundamental right to be represented by legal counsel. And this is another thing. When you're out here on the street, young guys, young men, young women, and you feel like you're being disrespected, you feel like you're being taken advantage of by any law enforcement agency, please, I want you to hear this loud and clear. Please do not wage a fight or an argument on the street, because you will lose. You will lose. Do you hear me?
Yes.
You will lose. It's a losing battle. Don't weigh that. Don't fight on the street. Please do not fight on the street, because then it gives them the opportunity and it gives them the excuse to do what? To say that louder,
to kill you,
or arrest you. So don't fight that fight on the street. You go and you deal with that later. There are processes within all of these law enforcement agencies, internal processes to address grievances. That's why there are external processes with the Michigan Department of Civil Rights, the NAACP, the Urban League, the MICA Center. We're here to fight for you and to help protect you and to help protect your rights. So please do not wage a fight or war on the streets. I was in court this week for 3 days with a gentleman who had an issue with his neighbor. Clearly the neighbor violated his space. He was disrespectful by crossing over his property. This gentleman who was the defendant asked this neighbor six times to not come on his property and to leave his property. six times. The perpetrator, the neighbor who crossed, basically said, I don't care what you say. I'm going to walk on this property when I want to, how I want to, and you can't do anything to me. The neighbor gets upset. He says, I'll come outside and I'll talk to you. What was the first mistake in that?
Going outside.
So he said, I'll come outside and I'll talk to you. The neighbor who was walking, trespassing on his property, goes to the front of the house, aggressively banging on his door, ringing his doorbell, in which he lied on the stand that he did not do that. He said he merely went around the property and stood in his driveway and patiently waited for this gentleman to come outside because he didn't know him. He just merely wanted to introduce himself and extend his hand and say, hi, I'm your neighbor. I'm your neighbor, glad to meet you. So he comes out, gentleman comes through his garage, and they get into, he asks him to leave. Why are you here? He refuses to leave. He goes back into his garage. He's going into the house, he says, to call the police. The gentleman follows him and reaches out and kind of grabs his neck. He said he didn't do any of this. He didn't grab him. He didn't reach out. He didn't touch him or anything. He didn't even follow him into his garage, is what he said. So the gentleman who owns the property, who asked him not to trespass, his natural reaction is what he told the jury was to grab a basketball iron about this thick in his garage because he thought he was being attacked. And he whapped him. So the gentleman who he hit has a contusion, just basically an abrasion, nothing major, goes to the hospital, he gets Tylenol. Several police units come. They surround the entire neighborhood, the entire house. And this gentleman leaves before the police, the homeowner leaves before the police gets there. But he goes down the next day and he says, I'm gonna make a report. Voluntarily, he goes down. Police officer, the detective, interviews him, talks to him, and then they immediately arrest him for assault. Initially, aggravated assault. They wanted him to do some things, so then they talked to him and wanted this gentleman, the property owner, to do some things. One of the things they wanted him to do was to sell his house, which is unheard of, which is unprecedented. You sell your house, we'll make this go away. He said, absolutely not. So then they upped the charges to aggravated assault with great bodily harm, the intent to do great bodily harm up to murder. He's looking at 10 years in prison. So we go through this court trial. I talked to the prosecutor, said this is excessive. It doesn't make any sense. We see video, the neighbor who's trespassing on the video is very aggressive. There's a lot of different words going back and forth. The jury, all white jury, and I thought his attorney, this gentleman's attorney, did a great, outstanding job, presented the evidence, presented the case well. There were lies that the detective was caught in, the alleged victim was caught in under oath. So I said, okay, this is a done deal. This is gonna be great. I think we got this. Jury came back, I left, I heard closing arguments, got a text from his attorney and said they found him guilty of aggravated assault with the intent to do great bodily harm with the intent to murder. They immediately locked him up and he's looking at 10 years in prison. He has a young son, young daughter, wife, and he is looking at 10 years in prison. And so the purpose of my telling that story is don't handle conflict, especially when you're dealing with law enforcement on the street. This gentleman went down, thought he was doing what he should be doing and trying to protect himself. He goes down, he talks to the detective and says, I want to tell you my story. But what was the first mistake he made with that? So He went down, he talked to the detective, the police, and said, I want to tell you my story. And they're taping his story. What was his mistake in doing that? No lawyer. I'm sorry? Absolutely. He had a right, I said earlier, to do what? To remain silent. He had a right to not self-incriminate himself. So, again, don't handle conflict on the street. It's a losing battle. Understand, and Mr. Lewis will get more into what your rights are. Understand what your rights are. Understand that there are organizations like the Michigan Department of Civil Rights, like the NAACP, like the Urban League, like the MICA Center, who can advocate for you and to support you. Understand that. We're resources. We have experienced folks who deal with this stuff every day. So understand that. And understand that this is not a joking matter. Understand that this is real. Understand that over the last several years, there have been women, men, and children murdered by law enforcement across this country. Understand that this is real and that this is serious. And I know this is early. I know it's early. And like I said, I know you guys are tasked throughout the week with a lot of work. But walk away understanding what your rights are today and really understanding, again, that, and I keep repeating this because I really want you to understand that we are here as adults to help you guys. We are here as adults. Again, my focus is to make sure that all of you young men and young women are good and that at some point you can take our places. We need you. We need you to be good. We need you to be right. We need you to be strong. We need you to build this community because we're not going to be here forever. So we need you. We need you. Understand that this, again, is serious. It's serious. You are a target. You are a target on many, many, many levels. And understand that we're here to support you and encourage you and to love you and to make sure you guys are good. And I don't know if we, I see Mr. Copeland is here. I want to acknowledge him, our membership chair. Mr. Copeland, if you could stand up. Mr. Copeland is our membership chair for NAACP. Let's give him a round of applause for coming out this morning as well. Hopefully he's here. I welcome you, I encourage you, any of the youth who are in the room who are not NAACP Youth Council members, I encourage you to become. I see we have some Youth Council members in the room with us. And I ask you to, I encourage you to become youth council members. I encourage you to be involved in our organization. And then we're going to do some scholarships as well to take care of the fees for you guys. So I think that's it for me. Mr. Lewis, let's give Mr. Anthony Lewis a round of applause. Maybe he'll wake you up this morning. Mr. Anthony Lewis.
I'm always happy when I get the opportunity to speak to a group of young people because, as I said, one of the things that when I got to the department years ago, one of the things I made a point was called the Michigan Youth Civil Rights Leadership Academy. And basically now it's run out of the University of Michigan. And I'll give you more information about that later because we are planning our fall conference. And now we're planning our fall conference, so we'll be sending out to all different schools throughout the state for our fall conference. But one of the things also is because I get the opportunity every couple of weeks because when I leave here today, I'm speaking to a group of from my fraternity, from my fraternity's youth program. I'm speaking to a group of young people this afternoon in Detroit. So one of the things I always want to stress in terms of first thing is I handed out some information to you. Okay, and one of the things is it says what to do when stopped by the police. Now that information that I handed out to you, that is from the Michigan Association of Chiefs of Police. Now, the reason why I handed that out to you, and I'm going to hand out a second, when I'm done, I'm going to hand out a second sheet that says, that's also about knowing your rights. But see, in life, you're going to get two different things. In life, you're going to get two different things. You're going to get two different types of information in life. And there's one thing you always need to understand. And that information, first, you're going to get information from people. That's fine. Oh, we'll do that. So what you're going to get is information. First of all, you have information in which people tell you what they want you to know. Okay? You're going to have a group of people that tell you what they want you to know. And then you're going to come across a group of people that'll tell you what you need to know. And sometimes those things aren't the same thing. Okay, and that's what I want you to understand. Sometimes those things are not the same thing, especially when you're dealing with something like law enforcement, when you're dealing with something like knowing your rights. Because understand something, and with all due respect to my law enforcement folks who are in the room, law enforcement likes an uneducated society. They love it. Law enforcement representatives, they will never admit this, but they love an uneducated, uninformed society. Because what that means is, they can do whatever they want to do. They can tell you that they have the right to do this when they really don't. And that's why I handed out that one form, because that form is from the Michigan Association of Chiefs of Police perspective. That's what they want you to know. Now, there are a lot of legal, they are, now, all those things in there are true, but also there are certain statements in there about how a police officer and the way they stand, and they're really just trying to protect you and they really want everybody to. No, some of those things just are not true. And that's why I wanted you to see that, because I'm going to hand you out another one, like I said, when I'm done, that's going to have some different information on it. A lot of the same, but you'll see how some things are worded differently and some things are said differently. Because we want to make sure you have the correct information. Because as I said before, remember, in life you're going to have you're going to get a lot of information as you grow up, a lot of information. And depending on who's giving it to you, it's going to be what they want you to know. And oftentimes you need to make sure you have the right source so that you can get the information that you actually need to know. So never get information. So for what I'm saying from now is never simply get your information from one place. Okay? Always, I come from a situation where you always question. You know, always question why. Well, hold it, why? Well, why is that? Are you sure about that? Why is that? Always, I came from, you know, myself, you know, born and raised in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, and, you know, and I went to school at Florida A&M University, which is a historically black institution in Tallahassee, Florida. And trust me, at the time when I was down there, the time when I was in Tallahassee, when I came down from Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, the first time somebody called me colored, I almost freaked out. Okay? See, because I grew up in the city. I grew up in Philly and the city. I had a whole different idea. So, but for that particular area, it wasn't a big deal. So you have to understand that. And it also comes from what Cleese said earlier. You know, sometimes you have to be smart. And what I mean by that is, your emotions are going to take you places, and your pride and wanting to be respected, sometimes it's going to get you in trouble. And that's why in terms of knowing your rights, that's why we're here, the Michigan Department of Civil Rights. Okay? That's what we do. Our job is to protect your rights. Period. Our job is first and foremost to protect your rights and hold those accountable who have violated your rights. That's our job. And second, our job is to educate you on what your rights are. So first, when you're in school, I'll start with knowing your rights in terms of school. Clee brought up a very interesting point, because now we're in a digital age. We're in a digital age where, you know, where you're texting, where now, I mean, I think how many of your schools allow you to have your cell phones in class? Yeah, because I mean, now some teachers are actually using that as a tool to help you, so that you can use that as a tool to help you. They have lesson plans online now. But what I want you to understand is texting. Just so you understand, I had a case. I give you a perfect example. I like to give war stories to help you. I like to give stories to help you understand. I just had a case where you had a student that texted, that sent text messages to a group chat. Okay, they sent a text message to a group chat saying F all ends to a group chat. Okay? They sent it to a group chat. Now this chat was passed between all the different, you know, the friends, and they were laughing, ha ha ha, until they added a person of color to that text message, by mistake, of course, but then they got it. Now you would think, well, hey, this is their personal stuff, right? It's personal cell phones. This is all going through their personal cell phones, right? So how could the school, how could anything happen to them, because this is their personal cell phones? Well, see, you have to understand, once a threat has occurred, which that is a threat, the school is obligated now to protect the students. So now, that student, so when you saw, so, but here's the thing. The student brought it to the attention of their principal. Initially, their principal didn't do anything. They just sat the student down, they talked to the student, and they didn't do anything. Well, guess what? Luckily, that particular student didn't stop there. They questioned that. They said, no, something about this doesn't seem right, which it's not. So then they called our office, and we got involved, and we opened up an investigation. And as a result of that investigation, because what that's considered, that's racial harassment. That's against the law. Okay? It's against Michigan law, which is the Elliot Larson Civil Rights Act here in Michigan, which you happen to have here in Michigan, the most comprehensive civil rights law in the country. So one of the things that it covers, because it covers a wide range of areas. But getting back to that case, now you have, when our department gets involved, we find that the school, because now the school could have ended it by simply holding the child accountable, right? By holding the person who sent the text messages accountable and holding the people that continue to forward the text messages accountable. Because, so you have to understand something. Once you have a threat and you've transferred the threat, now you're becoming an accomplice to the threat. You have now added to it. Well, now, because of our investigation, now we have the school being held accountable, and then as a result, you had many other students be held accountable. So from us, you had students. So now, as a result of our investigation, you had a school that had to go through training. You had a school that had to go through training. You had sanctions against the school, and then you had the students who were suspended. And one student was going to expel the student that initiated, but they decided to just give a 10-day suspension, a full suspension. So this is from a text message. from your personal phones to their personal phones, right? So why is that? So why do you think that would be a problem with it when it's your personal phone? Because I hear that a lot. Well, this is my stuff. This is my personal stuff. This doesn't have anything to do with the school. But guess what? Everything has to do. When you do it in school, or you do it with a classmate, now the school is involved. Any questions so far? Because I saw a hand up. Oh, you had a question? I can't hear. What did you say? What if your page gets hacked? Well, guess what? You have to prove that it got hacked. Because see, that's not a, see, you know what? Because see, and here's the thing, as those types of things evolve, like what if it gets hacked? What if my page gets hacked? You know, because a lot of times people get out of crimes for a wide range, you know, for a wide range of excuses, right? You know, I mean, someone who gets into an accident, you know, they can make up a reason, you know, they can make, well, help, I think I wasn't, you know, my car somehow just took over and went and, you know, and drove into that person. You know, you pressed the gas and you ran into someone. But that's how sometimes people, as a way of not being accountable for their own actions. Because you can't prove if your page was hacked. Yes.
So if I ask you why your page did that, then they get in trouble.
It's very possible if they can't prove that their page was hacked. That's why there's so many. That's why we always have what we have a division called, the Attorney General has a division called cybersecurity. And the reason is because so that way you can protect your passwords, you can protect all of those different things so that they are able to post and find out who if anybody did hack your page. But you also have to recognize, one thing that we do is under our powers, we also enlist other agencies to assist us when necessary. And what that means is, a couple of years ago, we enlisted the FBI to help us with a particular case. So they were able to trace certain things that we didn't have the capability to trace. So that's another thing you have to understand. Everybody works together. Everybody knows everybody. So just so you understand, especially in law enforcement, everybody works together. Everybody knows everybody. So don't think that because one particular law enforcement agency, you had an interaction with one particular law enforcement agency, that another particular law enforcement agency won't know. Let's say you have an interaction with a, let's say you have an interaction with a GRPD officer. Don't think that if you have an incident with a Kent County Sheriff deputy, that there wasn't any conversations at some point between the two that would not have led them to believe that you've had a previous interaction with the law enforcement officer. And that's why you always don't handle anything on site. Don't handle anything on site. Now, that's just some of the things, that's just one of the things in terms of from school, you know, that you can find. Because now, I think in the news, I think a lot of times you're hearing a lot of different things that are happening in schools where you have a lot of different students are being harassed because of their race, or students are being harassed because they're, you know, because they're Hispanic or Latino. Or, well, those are all things that our office would investigate. Okay? Those are all areas that our office would investigate because that's considered harassment. Now, not all forms of harassment are illegal. Okay, not forms of harassment are illegal. Sometimes the harassment is simply, it's not illegal. Sometimes it's just wrong, but it's not illegal. Might be immoral, but it's not illegal. And that's where you still have to come in time. That's where you still have to interact with your teachers. You still have to speak to your principal. But most importantly, you have to speak to your parents. Most importantly, you have to speak to those adults. You know, speak to those adults who you are close to, and confide in them and speak to them about anything that's going on. Now, from a law enforcement perspective, because that's one of the main things that I get today is in terms of law enforcement. What happens when you get stopped? Okay? Well, you do have one, I always say the exact same thing. You have the right to remain silent. What I say is, I always say this, just keep your mouth shut. Not you have the right to remain silent. That means, see, when people say you have the right to remain silent, that means we're giving you an option. I'm saying keep your mouth shut. Only ask a question that you are asked. Only answer a question that you are asked and answer it as briefly as possible. If you can answer it with a yes, answer it with a yes and that's it. Okay? Because what happens is unfortunately you find yourself in a time now where everyone, all law enforcement officers are not your friends. So you have to protect yourself also. So first, you want to remain silent. If you are driving or if you are walking, you want to remain silent. The officer may ask you, can I search your bag? You can tell the officer, no, you cannot search my bag. Okay, you do, yes. Now, if the officer has a search warrant, then they have to show that to you. If they reasonably believe that you have a weapon in the bag, then yes, they can search the bag without your consent. If they reasonably believe that you have a weapon, if they reasonably believe that there was a commission of a crime, then yes, they would be able to search your car or search your without your approval. And you had a question? Yes, or a comment? Yes.
You said just keep your mouth shut. By me keeping my mouth shut, won't that incite the officer to come at me a whole lot stronger than he already is?
Well, no, that's why I said only answer questions that you are asked. That's what I'm saying. Don't offer information. In terms of, you know, if someone asks you a question, license, registration, if you're in a car, just your license, registration, insurance, if someone's asking you, where are you going, what are you doing, you don't have to answer those questions.
Won't that make them angry?
Yes, it's very possible, you know what, they could respond in a particular way, but like I said, I would still say that oftentimes, unfortunately, what you may find yourself in a situation where, let's say you respond and say, well, I'm coming from the store. You don't know why, because the problem is you don't know what the response, why the officer is asking you these particular questions. Because an officer is supposed to come to you, if they're pulling you over for a particular, if you're in a car, they're supposed to ask you for your license, your registration, and your insurance. All of the, where are you going? What are you coming from? What are you doing? Those questions, while they can ask them, you are not required to answer those questions. It is possible, yes, that it could, but that does not constitute, your unwillingness to answer those questions does not constitute probable cause. So once again, you'll want to make sure you follow up. So once again, from that standpoint, yes, you want to make sure that you discreetly, and I say this, and I know, earlier you heard somebody say, well, they have a badge number and they have those things. I would strongly suggest that if you were to find yourself in that situation, you want to discreetly get a badge number or discreetly get a number off of the car, but do that discreetly. Because you don't want to find yourself in a situation where an officer would feel challenged, because you're asking them for their particular, because what happens is that unfortunately for certain officers, what you'll find is if they feel that they're challenged, then that would make them even more, that would make them not necessarily aggressive, but what we will do is they may find themselves at this point saying, you know what, I need to find something on this person because if the stop in their mind is not a valid stop, well then you don't want to give them an opportunity to make it a valid stop. Okay, so that's why I say discreet. You had a question.
So if they just pull me over for no reason, they have no right to search me?
No, what I'm saying is if you're pulled over by an officer, you do have the right to refuse to have your vehicle searched. But if, oh no, go ahead. If you're walking and an officer comes up to you and just says, I want to search you, they do have the right to pat you down for weapons.
So they can't go in my pocket or nothing?
No, that, like I said, you'd have to consent to that search unless the officer reasonably believes that you are carrying a weapon or that you may be carrying evidence for submission of a crime. And that's why you find these situations where officers have wide leeway when people are walking down the street and you find sometimes things, unfortunately situations happen because an officer can simply, and here's the problem when you have officers that may not operate with the highest levels of integrity, because yes, you can have an officer simply say, I believe they had a weapon, so that's why I wanted to search them. And that's why you have to follow, but that's also why at the scene, just sometimes it's best to just consent and then follow up later in those situations. If you believe that you could possibly be in danger, then consent. Consent to the search and then follow up with a complaint with our office, or follow up with a complaint with law enforcement, but as a young person, follow up with an adult immediately. Follow up with an adult immediately, whether it be a parent, whether it be someone that you're close to, follow up with them immediately.
So what if they say want to consent to the search, but they just really want to search you? Like, how do you know the difference?
Unfortunately, that's how our laws are written, where they give our law enforcement officers wide latitude to make those decisions on the scene. Okay, yes, exactly. Because an officer could say, well, afterwards, because what you're finding is that's what you find now. Officers are afterwards saying, after an encounter, they're saying, well, I believe my life was in danger. And that's why I was, that's why they fired their weapon. I mean, a perfect example is we have video where you have people running away from officers and officers unloading their weapon on them and them saying, well, I thought my life was in danger. So unfortunately, that's why I say you do have the right to do that. But sometimes you have to assess the situation, and sometimes it's best to consent, especially to consent to the particular search. If you're walking, like I said, if you're walking down the street, and then follow up with an adult from there, because you don't want to make an invalid stop all of a sudden become that. Okay, and that's the reason why so yes, it is possible. Unfortunately, you do have officers that, it is possible for you to find yourself in that situation where an officer can say that they believe that you have a weapon on you, or that you were in the commission of a crime. I mean, we see that all the time, unfortunately.
When I look at the words like probable cause,
exactly,
or reasonable belief, mm-hmm. Do these young men really have a choice in a search? Because it really don't seem like you got a choice.
And that's...
Because at any point, if I'm stopped, if I just say reasonable, and whatever that may be, or a reasonable cause or probable belief, so you really don't have a choice in the matter.
And that's where I say that officers and law enforcement, where they like to keep everything vague. Because an officer, after the fact, an officer can state that, yes, I believe that this was going on, and officers are giving wide latitude. That's why you do have the right to deny consent for a search. But like I said, that's why I always say, sometimes in these situations, it's best to just say, go ahead and search, and let's get it over with, and let's move. But you do have, like I said, but yes, with those types of vague terms, and that's why the law is purposefully vague, and those terms are purposefully vague, to give law enforcement officers a wide range for, as they say, to be able to uphold, the law and to fight crime, and that's, so yes. But that, I always say this also, adults, you have the power in that, because you have what's called a vote, and you also have what's called a voice, and you also have what's called a legislature, and those are the people that make those laws and write them exactly that way.
And what's interesting is that, because I want to piggyback on the comment that this gentleman made earlier, I was stopped, and I was asked the question, may I search your car? I said, no. The officer then said, well, you must have something in there. Mm-hmm. And so it's almost like a bait and switch. I mean, you can't even win in this situation. No, you can't. And then they end up searching the car anyway because he had reasonable belief. Did you find anything? No. But it's just, I guess, giving the young man the perception that they have an option, that you may not be searched, is kind of the wrong message, because you can.
No, what I'm saying is, no, first of all, giving them that you do have an option. Yes, you do, because you do have an option. I want to say, because to say that, well, no, we don't have an option. No, because that's not how the law, that's not the law, that you do have an option. Yes, unfortunately, you find yourself with, in these times, especially for young men in general, but especially for young people in general now, but especially for those under 18 and under 15, sure. Especially now, you do have the option. But given the situation now, yes, sometimes you have to consent. Sometimes it is best to consent to avoid what could happen later. But as the law is written, you do have an option. And yes, when you find yourself with these officers, because you know, a perfect example is in Washtenaw County. I'll give you a perfect example. In Washtenaw County, which is the Ann Arbor area, you have a sheriff there who his main concern is that everyone walks away with their dignity. Now it's interesting because this particular sheriff does not, if someone does not consent to a search, and they come and he, because they have body cameras, they have everything. So at this point, they have everything. But like I said, he will follow up. This is how he will follow up, and he will hold his deputies accountable if he finds that yes, they didn't consent to the search. You did the search anyway because you claimed, oh, now I think that they were finding something. He does the research. So like I said, you do have some law enforcement agencies and leadership, because they recognize that we are becoming a more informed society. I don't want to mess this up. We're becoming a more informed society. So that's why. But yes, I don't like taking away from and saying you don't have the option. You don't have the option to do this. But yes, sometimes it is best. I mean, you have the option. Okay, when you're in class,
yeah, you do.
Yeah, that's what I want to say. That's why, because when you're in school, you have the option of certain things that it's probably still not in your best interest to do those things.
Sure.
You know, when you're sitting in class. So, but like I said, that's why I want to make sure there's a difference.
And yeah, and my point is just probable cause and reasonable belief really trumps that option.
Well, probable cause and reasonable belief, it can. Yes, it can. But I don't want to leave anyone here saying, well, okay, that you do not have an option. The reason why I say that is because at that moment, you may feel like you don't have an option. That's why I say always once, that's why I say, you know, consent to the search and then follow up afterwards. That's always, like I said, consent. If you have to, if you feel threatened, consent to the search. And then follow up with agencies like ours, and then follow up afterwards. Because the last thing we want to see is any situation where it's escalated because you have a law enforcement officer who now has a preconceived idea about the particulars, who now has a preconceived idea, and then in the end, you lose.
Let me make a quick comment. But Lorenzo, you also have the option to sue. Mm-hmm. So the city of Grand Rapids, and I'm not sure if this suit is ongoing still, but there was an issue where Grand Rapids police notoriously was stopping young men, 17 and under, asking to photograph them and to fingerprint them. So there is a class action lawsuit, I'm not sure where that stands, with the ACLU and others, mm-hmm. Directly suing the city of Grand Rapids. So that is the trick. It's their trick to say reasonable belief or probable cause. So now when you file a class action suit, then it's up to them to prove what that probable cause looked like. So we have to understand that we do have options. We are protected by the Constitution of the United States, and people cannot violate our rights. We had that conversation with GRPD, with respect to photographing these young men and fingerprinting these young men, and allegedly they stopped that practice, is what we've been told. And so word on the street, however, is when I go out and I do these type of community conversations, young men come up to me and say, hey, Mr. Jackson, I was just stopped. And they took my photographs and they took my fingerprints. So we have to, again, we're a resource. There's nothing we can do from an NAACP perspective or an MDCR perspective or Urban League perspective, if we don't know what the issues that you guys are dealing with, but you do have that option to sue, and I think that is a very viable option. And I'll just say this, we need to start using that option more and more and more and more, regardless of whether we win or not.
And I also want to speak real quickly. Okay, I want to speak real quickly also to the something Clee said earlier about Grand Rapids Police Department undertaking right now racial profiling. I call it racial profiling study. But they are researching the stops and who they are stopping, and they're researching the stops and who they are stopping. I can tell you now that the group. I am very familiar with the organization and the leadership of the organization who is conducting the study. I am very familiar with them. Let's say that you need to stay vigilant in terms of following through, and I think you need to stay vigilant and you need to follow up and to ensure that they follow through on and they issue the results of the study.
And I think that was the young lady's point back here earlier, you need, in terms of how do we follow up, how do we hold them accountable,
how do we challenge
the data and all of that stuff that was the information that they're looking at.
Well, here's how. That's one of those ways. It's one of those ways that you challenge the data. One of those ways is also as you find out, because you do have FOIA, you have a Freedom of Information Act, which will give you access to that information. Okay, that'll give you access to that information. That's one. And then secondly, organizations like ours, because we have access to the information also. We can gain access. I'll put it that way. We can gain access to the information, but I can't stress this enough in terms of that particular study, that's going on, is that you follow up with Grand Rapids PD and ensure that the data that has been gathered, that they issue the report, the full report, and that you scrutinize and that you really look closely at the data as it is reported, because, as I said, I'm very familiar, I'm very close to the organization and the leadership of that organization that is currently doing the study. And let's just say, well, they did the same thing. This same organization did the same study in Kalamazoo. And is everybody familiar with how it turned out in Kalamazoo? Well, in Kalamazoo, they did the exact same study, and yes, they found that the Kalamazoo police were rampantly racially profiling their citizens.
I think we have one question over here.
Well,
you were just talking about how they profiled us. There was an instance that I went through where the police stopped me walking down the street. And their reason for was they told me that I was in a drug deemed area that was deemed a drug area.
Yeah, there's a lot of that.
And that I said, well, you know, I'm just walking down the street. Why are you stopping me? Well, this is an area that's deemed a drug area, so we have the right to stop you, detain you, and question you because of. So, I mean,
see, in that situation, that's where, like I said, that because of a notorious drug area, that would go to probable cause. From their perspective, it would go to how they would justify that stop. It would go to, we believe there's probable cause, and we believe those kind. We believe that because of this particular area. Now, from our perspective, and that's where we say, okay, at that point you would file a complaint with us that you believe you were stopped due to your race or due to, because then we would find the data and say, well, hold it, you're only stopping this group of people in that area. Because what you find, and I can tell you now, just as my former, when I was an investigator, plenty of times I found, in terms of when we investigated police departments, plenty of times I found that they had probable cause, but they were only using that probable cause on a certain group of people. So, like I said, that's why I want to. So, yes, if it's a, if they have deemed, because they have technology that tracks areas, they have technology that basically tracks where certain things are happening in certain areas. And so, yes, they can use, they can say there's probable cause, but that's what I'm saying, and what Cleve was talking about, you follow up because, you follow up afterwards.
Yeah, but they don't, I mean, in the white area, you know, they could have several houses on the same block that are deemed, that were raided or what have you, and there could be young male, there could be white males walking up and down the street all day, and never did they stop one of those white males. And these areas that I'm talking about are in the black neighborhood.
No, exactly, and that's why you have an off, and that's why. And that's why we also look at things called, what's a legal term, so I don't want to kind of get into that, but that's why we look into things like disparate impact, where you have a, where, and basically what that means is, that means you can have a rule that on its face is neutral. It's like, yeah, it applies to everybody. But the problem is, when you actually apply that rule, it only affects one group of people, when you actually apply that rule. So that's why we look at those types. That's why we look at those types of things, and that's why I'm saying we always say follow up afterwards. You know, when you come behind, and that way we can follow up. You know, with our office, and we can follow up from there. Say hand up.
So who do you call if the police are breaking the law?
When your police are, you know what? You would call. You can call our office. You also hear federally. You have your federal partners, because that's who would, when law enforcement officers, you know, break the law, depending on which law, like if they're local, or state law enforcement officers, then you need to file complaints with your local, like the FBI and with the U.S. Attorney's Office, and I can get that information to you. I always give everybody my phone number. Because I always try to give out my business card and my phone number as someone to contact if you believe. Because sometimes you need an advocate, and you need an advocate that knows people. You know, because when I got into this particular business, one of the things I always said was I was always going to use my position to be that conduit to someone who may not have the opportunity, because plenty of times I've been able to just pick up the phone and call the U.S. attorney and call their cell phone number and say, hey, look, this is what's happening, and been able to have an investigation started, whereas under any other circumstance, it would have been ignored. And that's what I'm saying, but you have to contact, for local law enforcement, you would have to go to the next round, which would be your state, which would, you know, file a complaint with the state, with us, or the federal government. But like I said, if you have any questions, I'll give you my card and you can give me a call and I can explain the process to you, because it's a long, drawn out process.
Quickly, I want to make sure. Are there any brochures for us to have to introduce our young men at Messiah to the NAACP Council?
Clee would have that could have that information, yeah.
To the NAACP Youth Council,
by the Copeland.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. If
you want to take one more question, then we'll shut it down.
Okay. Yeah, I see you running by.
Yeah, I gave you my card, right? So if anybody wants any information in terms of if there are specific groups, specific church organizations or whatever, I'll leave cards up here. You can talk to Mr. Copeland. We can come out and do a session on the youth council and talk to a group or whatever. We have our membership meeting the third Tuesday of every month, 7:15 p.m. at our offices in the Lynch Building at 1167 Madison. So you're welcome to come there. The youth council meetings are first and the third Sunday of each month, I think at 3 o'clock. And so you're welcome to come there as well. You can send, my email will be on the card. You can send me an email and then we can get you guys connected.
Exactly. Any other questions? And also, if you're interested in the, Michigan Civil Rights Youth Leadership Academy, which is something that we started with the University of Michigan. We're now getting ready. We're expanding it to different areas throughout the state. We're currently in discussions right now with with GVSU, so to bring it there. So like I said, so I can get that information to you also, because that's one of our goals also, is to train people and to grow the next generation to take my place. So basically that's what to take my place and what on the things that I do. So are there any questions? Because I know there's a lot to go through, and I'm not sure. I didn't really get a chance to get through the stuff I wanted to. So any other questions?